Ren'py is a powerful tool for creating visual novels, but to be honest, it kind of has a bit of a learning curve. You actually have to know how to program. That almost stopped me from making my own dream games.
Until I learned a deep, dark secret about the world of programming.
Copy and paste. Programmers just pass around bits of code like it's candy or something on Halloween, and you just have it. In fact, you can have this code. I made some code for you. It's right down in the description. Comes prepackaged with every major component you're going to need to make a visual novel on your own. And for the rest of the video, I'm just going to explain how it works. Which means you might just learn Ren'py too. The most important element of Ren'py is the dialogue. Ren'py will read and implement lines of code one at a time until it reaches a dialogue. Then it will display the dialogue on screen and stops there until the user clicks or taps the screen or clicks the spacebar. Once they do, Ren'py will remove the dialogue and continue to read the code until the next line of dialogue. We can display the dialogue with a simple quotation, like in line 7, but we could also display a name along with the text by putting a name in quotations right before the dialogue, like here in lines 18 and 23. If you want to do more complicated things with individual characters and dialogue boxes, you'll need to define a character. Back at line 1, we defined E as a character with the attributes Eileen, which is the name, and then a color with a hex code designation separated by a comma. If we didn't want a custom color for this character, we could have just written character Eileen. But when you have multiple characters, having custom colors helps visually separate them better. To use the definition you just made, just use the tag E, which is, you know, the custom definition that I set it as up top, followed by the dialogue and quotations like in line 11. You can put custom tags and code in the text itself too. Backslash quotation mark will let you put quotation marks inside a text without closing your dialogue statement. Any text between this U in brackets and the slash U in brackets will be underlined. That brackets and slash format's gonna be used like a lot. Like B in there will bold the text, or an I will italicize the text. Text size can be adjusted with size equal to plus or minus a number value. Ended with, no, slash thing again. You can also change the color of the text by setting a hex code. Now there's a lot more functionality behind the text and dialogue system, which we'll get a little bit more into later, especially this weird line of code. But this should cover most of what you need. In my opinion, the easiest thing to implement in Ren'py is sound and audio, so I really only included one line there, but there's a lot of variation you can add to it. Honestly, nowhere near as much as there are for images. Images can get really complicated, but for this batch of code, we're gonna stick with some predefined functions that Ren'py comes with in the box. Any picture that is in the images folder can be displayed in Ren'py using the show and scene statements. Use one of these statements followed by the name of the image, and they will be displayed on the screen. You'll want to use the scene statement for the backmost layer of a scene. Every image displayed afterwards, you'll want to use the show statement. You can use the show statement to display as many images as you want, but you can only ever show one scene. That's because when you use the statement scene, every image afterwards is considered part of that scene. If you were to use scene to define an image later, like at line 42, it'll remove everything from the screen from that scene and start over with the new scene image. At line 6, you'll notice we've shown Eileen happy, and at line 10, we're using the show statement again to display Eileen concerned. But instead of displaying two images, it just changed the image we already showed before. That's because Ren'py automatically parses images by reading the first word as the actual image, called a tag, and the second word as an attribute. This is a helpful feature when it comes to manipulating images. For instance, if you need to hide an individual image, you can use the hide statement, but you don't need to name the individual file, you just need to specify the tag, and it will remove any image that has the name tag. We can also manipulate images with transforms and transitions. These work with the scene, show, and hide statements. Transforms control where a character is displayed and moved on the screen, and I'll make a separate video on the subject later where we can get into, you know, heavily customized transforms, but for now, know that at left, at center, and at right are options to place the character on the screen. Transitions apply effects to changes on the entire screen. There are a ton of predefined transitions, and they're worth experimenting with, but I put all my favorite ones in this short VN. At line 10, I use with move, which takes elements on the screen that are changing position and moves them into their new position. In this case, moving Eileen from the center to the left. At line 16, I use pixelate, which pixelates the screen into big blocks and pixelates them back from the changed screen. In line 21, I use dissolve, which will fade the screen from the initial placement of objects to the new one. At line 42, I use V-punch, which does this cool thing. The transform and transition can be put in any order, so at left with move is the same as move at left. So let's go back to the tag attribute naming system for images. Because the tag is what the image is considered to be, we could have written show Eileen at left with move if we didn't want her to change expression while moving. This is also helpful if we just do not know what expression she'd have. Why wouldn't we know what expression she has? Well, since we've gone over the basics of, you know, dialogue, sound, images, let's kind of take a step back and look at how Ren'py is going to parse through the code.
All right, boys, after we check both of these predefined values, we're going to start playing the game at label start. We go down line by line until it reaches this call statement, question selector. A call statement is the equivalent to taking everything from here, placing it here. After we run through this code, we're displaying a menu with three options. The third option will jump us back to the question, which creates a loop the user will be on until they select either option one or option two. When the user selects option one or option two, each runs a couple lines of code, but then proceeds through to jump to the end, which then ends the game with a final return tag. As for you, if you're finding this tutorial helpful so far, please consider clicking the like and subscribe buttons below.
So as we can see, the most important components for flowing through the code are label, call, menu, and jump. Label gives a name to a section of code. Labels need to be unique designations, no duplicates, so longer names are suggested. The labels also don't need to be in the same .rpy file, so you can create a new document, move this label, question selector to that document, and the code will run the same as before. When we want to jump over an area of code to get to another section of code, we'll use the jump statement, followed by the name of the label we want to jump to. When we want to jump to a statement and then jump back, we'll use the call statement, followed by the name of that label. We usually do this when we want to do some repetitious action or figure out a variable. When we use call in a section of code, we use the return tag to say, we're done with this section of code. Notice the game ends at line 45 with return. That's because this entire batch of code was called from the main menu screen. If we want to give the user choices, we'll use the menu statement, followed by the options listed in quotation marks with a colon at the end. When the user clicks each of these, Ren'py runs the code underneath the option. We can use this to create branching paths. In this case, we can select the third option, which loops us back to the label of the question, or we can press options 1 or 2, which display either this dialogue in action or this dialogue in action. But then both just proceed past the menu to the end with a minor text change. But we don't always have to create branching paths based directly off of player input. Sometimes we can have a little bit more control behind the scenes than what it looks like on the screen. Remember that dialogue that had words in brackets? When we set things in brackets in dialogue, we're referring to variables, which are values or strings of text that we can change during the course of a playthrough. When this pops up the first time, this line will read as question one. Huh? To set these variables, we need to use Python code. We do that by either placing it outside of our game before label start by stating define, or if we're setting a variable in our code, we'll use a dollar sign. The dollar sign tells Ren'py everything in this line of code is a Python statement. You'll see it used in other contexts, but for our purposes in this game, we're only using Python statements to set variables. So after we use either the dollar sign or define, we'll want to state what the variable's name will be, set it equal to a value, and then place the value it's equal to at the end. In line 2, for instance, we're setting a variable equal to 0, or at line 35, we're setting a variable to the string value.
Huh?
Variables don't have to be static, though. In line 37, inside the code we're calling in the loop, we want the variable question tally to go up by 1 every time we call this code. So we use plus equal sign to add a number and negative equal sign to subtract a number. In this case, we want the tally to go up by 1, so that's plus equal to 1. Now let's say I want this question to be randomized every time it comes up. Well, this gives us an opportunity to look at conditional statements. To start, at line 29, we're making a variable number generator equal to a random number. The code we set to a random number is utilizing some pretty advanced Ren'py functionality, so don't worry about it too much. Just know that you can set the random number between whatever two integers you put on either side of the comma. So in this case, the variable number generator will randomly be 1, 2, or 3. Depending on what number that is, one of these conditional statements from lines 30 to 35 will activate. We're going to start with the condition if, and if that condition isn't met, we'll move on to elif, short for else if. And if all the above conditions are not met, we'll use the statement under else. If we only want something to happen if one condition is met, we can just use the if condition. If we want something to happen if one or more conditions are met, we can use one if condition and as many else if conditions as we want. But if we want something to happen no matter what conditions we enter in, this if, else if, and else set covers pretty much everything. If the variable number generator is equal to 3, then we're setting another variable, repeat question, to what? Notice the double equal signs here. This is used in cases where we're questioning the value of a variable. If the number generator is greater or equal to 2, then the variable repeat question will be, say it again. Notice this condition is met if the number is 2 or 3, but because the if condition activates if the number is 3, Ren'py won't read this else if statement anyway. To be on the safe side though, if you want, you can add additional conditions to this line. In this case, we want the number to be greater than, equal to 2, and less than 3. If you want, you can string as many conditions as you want. For fun, I'll add an OR condition if number generator is equal to 5. The random number will never be 5, but this condition will be met if either of these two sets of statements are correct. Finally, if none of the previous conditions are met, then the variable repeat question will be set to huh. Now under these, at line 36, notice the line is red. That's because the pound sign lets us set a comment on our code. A comment means that Ren'py won't parse any of the text here behind the pound sign, so generally you'll use these a lot to label stuff, clarify what certain code does, or use it to turn off certain sections of code, or even just leave notes for yourself. In this case, I've commented out a line of code that does everything we've done in lines 29 through 35. Here we use Ren'py.random.choice to select one of these three choices, and then make it equal to the variable repeat question. There's a lot of really complicated RenPy functions, but honestly, between the setting variables and, you know, condition statements, you can pretty much replicate most of them on your own. So don't worry about, you know, learning every single like fancy RenPy.something.something. You can kind of figure it out on your own. And with that, I have gone in exhausting detail about how these 44 lines of code work. So, you know, feel free to copy and paste whatever you want. In fact, if you want to test the code yourself in Engine, all the assets I used, they come in the Ren'py tutorial as is. So go ahead and create your own project, and then take the images folder from the Ren'py tutorial game and place it in your project along with this audio file, renpyallstars.ogg, and throw that in the audio folder. Paste the text in the scripts.rpy file and press launch project to see the professional looking. Yeah, guess I never went over UI, did I? Kind of important. Yeah, go ahead and click on the Ren'py UI tutorial thing right here and I'll go ahead and get started working on it, okay? Whew. All right, let's see, I should start. What's up YouTube, it's your boy here. No, I do not like that, let's try something else there.